next time job is there, so good. Okay, so how many of you are from Delhi? A lot. And how many of you are here post your BBA? Very few. Okay. Just wanted to check. Okay, I'll spend the next, let's say, half an hour, 35 minutes talking to you about the industry familiarization, the industry expectation. Now, I'm not here to give you any gyan, because that you already have enough of. I'm here to give you some experiences, some of my learnings, what I think would be useful if you think about that and try and imbibe that in your day-to-day life. So I work for Fortis. Fortis is a healthcare organization. It's one of the largest in the country. I'll just walk you through first a healthcare space scam kind of a thing. Why I'm doing it? Because healthcare right now, like education, is at the top in the service sector. They're doing extremely well, both education and healthcare. So healthcare is becoming employer of choice. People do look up to healthcare. That wasn't the scenario even 6-7 years ago. People used to wonder about healthcare. Okay, is a good place to work or not? But now it is a sought after area. So I'll just give you a brief scan on the Indian healthcare landscape. Some interesting statistics I want to share with you. India has about 17% of the world's population. You're all aware of that. 20% of the world's disease burden is in India, and one of the lowest health spending as a proportion of its GDP. So that is the healthcare equation. 17% of the world population is in India. 20% of the global diseases are in India, and we are one of the lowest spenders on healthcare as a percentage of our GDP. So there's a big demand and supply gap. If you look at the first big circle, that's the world disease burden I talked about. 20% is in India, 17% world population, 8% of the global doctors are in India, and only 6% of the beds are in India. So that's the coverage of healthcare. You can now start analyzing that there's a huge gap which exists in healthcare. And that is an opportunity for growth. There's a lot to be done. Whatever, let's say, improvements in the business scenario or the service sector scenario of healthcare you're observing for the past, let's say, 10 years, that is just a scratch on the surface. It is poised for huge growth in the future because there's a huge demand to be met. And the demand will continue to bloat, increase, and the numbers will keep becoming bigger and bigger. The Indian healthcare sector, like I mentioned, has got very strong growth prospects. It's the third largest contributor to the Indian economy in terms of revenue and employment generation potential. 15% CAGR, poised to reach $158 billion in 2017. It's one of the key strategic focus areas in the current five-year plan. Healthcare segment, when we say, it includes hospitals, pharmaceutical organizations, medical equipment organizations and suppliers, medical insurance and diagnostics. That's the space of healthcare. Out of this, the hospital services is the largest, and it's about $81 billion in this year itself. So it's more than 50% of the overall plan till 2017. Healthcare expenditure in developed nations is close to 10% of the GDP. Those are the advanced nations we talk about. In India, it's just 4% of GDP. So we can understand there's a lot to be done. There's a lot of gap to be filled up. This bar graph also shows you the gap. If you look at the first bar, we've got almost one bed per 1,000 population. The global average is 3. We've got 0.65 physician doctor versus 1.4. We got one nurse for 1,000 people, where the global average is close to 3. So you can start understanding the numbers, the opportunity which sits in front of us. A brief about the organization I represent, Fortis Healthcare. The map shows you our presence in the country. It was incorporated in 96. First hospital came up in 2001. We just celebrated the 14th birthday of that hospital. So we are still a teenage company. 55 healthcare delivery facilities in India, including 35 large facilities and 20 small and satellite heart command centers. 7 hospitals as we speak are under development or expansion. Most of our hospitals are internationally accredited. We got JCIs, NABH certifications, which are like the ISO standards for the manufacturing and quality aspects. We are present across key specialties and tertiary care like cardiac sciences, neurology, ortho, renal, gastro, oncology and pulmonology. So these are the streams we treat people in. We are present in 17 states and 34 cities in India. That makes us, I think, if you look at the footprint, we are the largest in the country. Now, what does a year in life of Fortis looks like? We perform about 74,000 cardiac procedures every year, 22,000 orthopedic procedures, and this number is rapidly increasing because people are becoming very conscious. 26,000 oncology treatments, 9,000 plus babies delivered through mother and child hospitals, and 1,30,000 dialysis patients. So this is just a snapshot to tell you what goes on in the life of Fortis in a year. So we touch millions of lives every year. So that's our Forte. We are into business of health. We touch people. This is how the organization has grown. From single hospital entity in 2001 to a 55 hospital entity now. There's been a rapid growth. A lot of it has come through acquisitions, which gave fresh challenges to the human resource function because of the cultural disparities between various hospital chains. But the growth has been stupendous, and it's the fastest growing healthcare chain in the country. Our values at Fortis, every organization has values. Patient centricity, integrity, teamwork, ownership, innovation. These are the values we work for, these are the values we are proud of. And we live these values day in and day out. What is it like to work at Fortis? What are the kind of attributes we are looking at? What's the atmosphere we provide? It's a very empowering atmosphere. And I'm not saying just because I'm here to talk to you. It actually is a very empowering atmosphere over there. People are free to take calls. It's a very dynamic, very energetic, and very fast-paced atmosphere we provide in the organization. A very approachable senior leadership. We pride ourselves on that. A lot of mentoring programs. In fact, we have mentoring programs both sides. It's not that a senior is mentoring a subordinate. We have the reverse mentoring process also, where the youngsters mentor a senior colleague on the new ways of life and new ways of doing things. We promote internal talent through our internal job postings, and we monitor it. We prefer to grow people from within the system than to hire from outside. High potential identification and development. We are very proud of the learning and development opportunities we provide to our people. Internal talent is sent out for leadership development programs, and they grow in the organization. Engaged and committed workforce, because in our case, the level of engagement directly impacts the outcome of your clinical outcomes. Potential-based succession planning, and basically a big fun place to work. We have a lot of rewards and recognition and learning programs, and almost every week we have some event happening somewhere in the organization. We are a widespread organization. So a lot of things happen at Fortis, and a lot of people activities, engagement activities continue to happen at Fortis. Now, what do we look for in a quotation. We look for a person who's got a lot of energy and dynamism. We look for a person who's got ability to change and to master change. We look for a person who's ambitious, who's got the drive. We look for a person who's a good team player. We look for a person who's innovative. A person who challenges status quo. Person who can operate at high speed with a sense of urgency, doing things now, not waiting for tomorrow. Tolerance for ambiguity, because when you're growing fast, everything is not crystal clear. You have to decide looking at ambiguity. Of course, integrity is top notch. Community oriented, because we do a lot of community based programs. And of course, a passion to excel, passion for excellence. So these are some of the in our dictionary of a Fortisian. For you, it's the beginning. You are now entering a new phase of your life. And congratulations for making this decision. In the next 2 years, you'll be out working for a great organization. And you'll be contributing to the success of the organization to make it an excellent place. Now, let me take you back. Why Indians have been very successful? If you look at people, you have great names outside India also. Why Indians have been very successful in work, even outside India? These are the attributes. And there's a purpose I'm trying to show you with this slide. If you look at the big names, Indra Nui, Panga from MasterCard, you name many people, Microsoft head. Why are they there? They made it big. Because as a culture, being an Indian, we are hardworking primarily. We are innovative. We find a way. And I don't want to demean it by saying Jugaad, because a lot of people love talking the word Jugaad, but fine. It does not take away from the fact that it is innovation. It's a positive innovation. We do add value. One of the very strong things is we are committed to the job. I've had the pleasure of working in many multinational organizations, Britishers, Americans. The kind of commitment an Indian has on the job is not there, either in a Brit or in an American. It's not there. And that is what drives Indians. That is what has made Indians succeed outside India. Because they beat everybody hands down. They're committed. They're emotionally connected to the job. Proud about our culture and nationality. We have to prove ourselves. I come from India. I must be better than anybody else. I must prove myself. So that drive also has made us excel. And being in India, we are used to living in a multi-ethnic, multicultural atmosphere. Every state has a different culture. Every state has a different language. We are used to these things. So we adapt ourselves very well outside and when we go. Now, let's talk about you. A lot of classes have been taken about Generation Y. So you, all of you would have been born in mid-90s and later. Correct? You are a generation which has always seen plenty. Everything is available. Everything is just a click away. You get it. But if you look at the generation before that, it wasn't such a generation. It was a generation of rationing. There was an era called rationing. The kids of today have no clue about rationing. You heard about a ration card? Why does it exist? Because there was an era of rationing. There was food which was available. You had to stand in queue outside a ration shop to get your food. So it comes from that era. To get a Bajaj scooter, you had to wait for 15 to 20 years. To get a landline, you had to wait for 7 to 10 years. So that was the era. So you're very lucky that you are in an era which is an era of opulence, plenty. Everything is available. Great time to be born in India. You're a generation which is highly aware because of Dr. Google. He gives you all the answers at just the click of a button. So you have the advantage. The earlier generation had, they never had Dr. Google with them. They had to sit in libraries, find books, read, and then come out with solutions. You're lucky. You just press the button, get the answer. There is a drive in all of you, I see, to change the world. I'm going to now do this and I'm going to change it. You have got a dream. You have that passion to excel, which we were very submissive when we started a career. Very afraid when we entered a new domain. I don't see that fear factor now, which is very good. You're all confident of yourself. You're confident of what you want to achieve. You've got your plans in place. Good thing that young India is there. Half the Indian population is under 25 years of age, which is an advantage, and that you are constituting that advantage. And of course, this is the fastest growing segment in today's workforce, the young generation. You want more, and then you want more. You've seen the Amazon ad? Or the cow? You're never satisfied. Keep wanting more and more and more and more. So which is good. Can you read the cartoon? Okay, I'll read it out for you. The father is asking a young girl, "Hi sweetie, how was your school today?" So she's responding, "You can read all about it on my blog, Dad." That's the generation. That's how we communicate. All tech savvy, armed with Blackberries are out now. Laptops, cell phones and other gadgets. Completely clued on, completely connected all the time. You want flexible schedules, better work-life balance, vacations. That's your dream of work life. You're very achievement-oriented, like I mentioned, ambitious. You seek out new challenges and are not afraid to question authority. You question status quo. That leads to innovation. That leads to new ways of working. So, very, very good. Now, this is the hierarchy in an organization. It's a triangle, pyramid. Starting from a team member, you move to a subject matter expert in the field of your domain. Then you reach middle management, and then you reach senior management. That's the usual career path in an organization. So, you are here currently as a student. What is the transition which you have to make from a student to a team member, which is the entry point in an organization? And you have a long way to go. The pyramid is, it takes about 20 plus years for some. Some it may be faster, but it takes at least 20 plus years to reach the yellow part of the pyramid. So what are the gaps? What you need to do to adapt, how to bridge the gap. Some of the things which I want to share with you, the knowledge which you're going to gain in the next 2 years, please retain that knowledge and apply that. And I'll talk more about it later. The education system which we have now does not allow us, because we are now following semester systems along for every 6 months, we forget what we've done the last 6 months. Please get into the habit of retaining the knowledge which you are gaining, because it is going to last you a lifetime. This is the differentiator when you enter a job. Stretch out to reach the goals, have the attitude to work hard. There's no easy way to success. Even if somebody tells you he's wrong, success only comes after a lot of perseverance and hard work. There is no shortcut. So be prepared to strive very hard, work hard, stretch, reach your larger objectives, goals. Work hard, but also work smart. Adhere to the values and commitments, that does matter. When you enter an organization, you will be seeing a lot of posters on the walls that these are the values this organization espouses. You may agree, you may not agree with some of the values, because you are an individual. But when you are in an organization, you are working for the organization. You are entitled to have your own value system, but network of the organization value, which is important. So adhere to that. And can you read the cartoon here? Okay, again, a grandfather talking to a granddaughter. She's asking, what are you doing, grandfather? So he's responding, it's called reading. It's how people install new software into their brains. So that was the era. Now I think the habit of reading is getting out. We don't read as much as our earlier generation used to. So one of my requests to all of you is, please read. How many of you read newspapers every day? See? Not even 10%. How do you get the daily dose of news? Forget TV. I'm not asking TV. Apps. Would you read the apps now? Okay, so you read. Okay. So that's good. See, in our times, when we were studying, there were no Googles, there was nothing, there was no softwares. How the thing got into a brain, we had to read a book. And this logic what I'm trying to talk to you about. When you read a book, you are retaining something in your brain. Because you know that there is a time when I would be asked this question, I might have to write it down or talk about it. Better to retain it. What has changed? Number one, we don't read. Because we always know that there is Google. So whenever we would be asked a question, we can always Google it. So what has happened? Our retention abilities in the brain have diminished. Let me ask you a question. How many telephone numbers do you remember? 6 to 7, maximum 10. Why? Because everything is stored in your cell phone. You don't have to remember. But there was a time when you used to remember at least 50 to 60 numbers, all friends, on fingertips, because we had no cell phones. So what is it doing to our brains? The technology is making our brains redundant. While we do things faster, we do things quicker, we have more information at our fingertips, but it's all outside our brain. So my point is that please, if you continue to read, you will continue to store things in your brain, and God forbid if internet shuts down tomorrow. What happens to the world? What will you do? There is no Google. There is nothing. All smartphones are dead. What happens to that? Have you ever thought about that day? It can happen. It's only a cable which is running under the sea. It brings internet to India. It can snap. 10 days, no internet. Just imagine that scenario. No YouTube. No Facebook. No WhatsApp. So, just a point I wanted to make. Read. I always urge youngsters, please read. Because it keeps your brain engaged. Knowledge is stored there, not on a memory chip on a cell phone. How do you create the edge? There are hundreds and thousands of students currently sitting and studying MBA. How do you become different? What is your plan? As they call it, it's going to be a rat race after 2 years. How will you win that race? How can you start preparing yourself? How can you create that specific competitive edge about yourself, a differentiator? Insights, like I just mentioned, read more about the current industry trends. Don't wait that, okay, when my job starts, at that point of time I'll start reading. That time, you will have no time. You'll be in the job, 100%, following objectives of the organization, running after goals. You have no time at that point of time. I can guarantee that to you. Now is the time. Whatever you plan to do when you start a job, please start doing it now. That time you will have no time. Learn about new concepts. Look at your research projects, case studies, and then learn from that. Be innovative when you choose your project. Reach out to corporates for projects in your domain. Look at short projects which you can complete and learn quick wins. And then that will be good for you and the organization you work for that project. There are summer internships which happen. I've handled thousands of students in summer internships. Very few students are serious because that's the time, that's the summer time, 3 months or let's say 8 weeks when you're there. That's the time to learn about the organization, to know about the culture, to know about the finer corporate nuances. Don't while away that time. Please focus and make value addition in yourself and the project you're working for. That's very, very essential. Generate career options before your final placement. So your performance and internship, like I just mentioned, that creates an edge. We've also had students. We also had students who have been summer interns with us that we must get the student. It is great. That's value addition. That's the edge you're creating about yourself. You're branding yourself. That I'm a great hire, so please get me on board. Networking and grooming. You'll be meeting new people from industry. Continue to do that. Be agile. Learn from them. I'm again saying read and apply that knowledge. Focus on your language communication. It is very, very important. Communication plays a very important role in corporate life. So you may be good at communication on WhatsApp and talking to your friends, but that's not the communication the corporates are looking at. We're looking at business communication, how you can talk in meetings, how you can convince your clients, how you can get orders from the organization. So that's the kind of communication. So practice. Start now. Now is the time to learn. A snapshot. First is personal proficiency, high domain knowledge, and character integrity. These are no-brainers. These are very, very essential things to have when you start your careers. Humility and humbleness. Whatever you do, you may be a topper in the organization. Humility and humbleness is what will take you far. Emotional intelligence. Being sensitive not only about yourself, but about your surroundings, about your other people also. That's a very key aspect in management, emotional intelligence. Because you will be leading people, teams of people, and this will come handy. Be executioners, doers with a sense of urgency. India is very good at planning. We plan a lot, but we always crib about execution. So tomorrow, today, you being students, you can crib about government, ye nahi hota, wo nahi hota, kuch nahi hota yahan pe, all those things. Tomorrow, you will be in that position. And somebody else will be cribbing about you. कुछ नहीं करते हैं बातें करते हैं प्लान करते हैं नथिंग हैपेंस सो वी एज अ नेशन हैव टू चेंज वी हैव टू बी एग्जीक्यूशन ओरिएंटेड व्हिच वी आर नॉट एज अ फॉर सो इट्स अ रिक्वेस्ट टू द यंग जनरेशन दैट डोंट रिपीट व्हाट वी डिड इन आवर टाइम्स बी एग्जीक्यूशनर अ नेशन ऑफ एग्जीक्यूशनर्स अ नेशन ऑफ डूअर्स विद अ सेंस ऑफ प्राइड एंड अर्जेंसी बी अ टैलेंट डेवलपर दैट्स द बिगेस्ट ट्रेट ऑफ अ लीडर. When you study the leadership, the biggest trait of a leader is to develop other leaders. So start nurturing that thought in your mind now. It starts now. Don't wait for you to get into a job, then you will start nurturing it. Please start now. One thing which I want to talk, which is at the last of the slide here, is the national pride. I speak about this at every forum I go because this is one thing which I see diminishing. I'm not saying it's missing, it's diminishing generation after generation. The sense of national pride. When you get into your jobs, when you get the opportunity of traveling outside India, some of you already might have, go to countries like Japan, China, even countries like Indonesia, Malaysia. One thing which strikes you over there, the moment you land at the airport, is the sense of pride everybody has in their country. And it's the exact opposite when you come back to India. How do we develop this sense of national pride? Because the moment you have that sense of pride that I must do this for my nation, nation comes first. Then the organization, then self. That is diminishing. So it's again a request from my side. I don't know whether you completely understand what I'm trying to tell you, but the sense of national pride, being an Indian and standing up for India in whatever you do, that will make sure that you do the right thing for the country, you do the right thing for the nation, and you stand up as a citizen of the country. So it's a request from my side. Be very proud of who you are. And as a nation, we lack this pride index. Small nations are doing pretty well because the citizens are very proud of what they're doing over there. Be a winner. Look at adversity. Look at opportunities. When you enter corporate life, you will not always be greeted with garlands and roses. There'll be tough times. There'll be tough calls. How do you start training yourself to look at those calls now? Student life is good, very nice, but the work culture will be slightly different. There will be big challenges. So look for opportunities in adversity. It's a question about perspective. There have been downturns. 2008 was a massive downturn. But if you look at the companies which started in that downturn, they are doing fantastically well. There's an example I always quote. Low-cost airlines, which is Southwest Airlines and JetBlue Airlines Corp of US. They started operating when all other major airlines were crashing because of the market downturn. They looked at the opportunity and they are doing extremely well. JetBlue is doing extremely well. So there's an opportunity in that adversity. So have that mindset of not getting bogged down by adversity, but looking at the positive which may come out of that adversity. One attribute of winners is take risks and be very patient about it. Have perseverance. I'll give an example of the Everest. It's been attempted about, let's say, 11,000 times. People have tried to reach the summit. 3,000 attempts have been successful, which is, let's say, just about 27-26%. 1 in 10 successful climbs to the summit ends in death. But have people stopped? No. There are still people who are trying to climb, knowing that only 26% of them would reach the summit. That's the statistic. Tenzing Norgay, we all know about, unsuccessfully tried to get to the top of Everest 6 times before he finally made it with Hillary. Had he given up after the first attempt or the second attempt or the third attempt, you would not know his name. But he never gave up. He persisted. He knew he could do it. He kept at it. And the lesson we learned from him is that please first, take the first step, make an attempt, and then be patient about it. Success follows those who are perseverant, who have perseverance, who are patient. You may fail. As they say, failure is your best teacher. You will not repeat that again. So it's a small lesson on perseverance. As you enter corporate life, you will be finding yourself at a place where a lot of expectation from you, a lot of things you are expected to do, you are expected to deliver 100 things. You don't have time. You may fail at 10, you may deliver 90, but don't let that 10, failure of 10, bog you down. Keep at it. Life is not so bad. Corporate life will teach you a lot of things, but be ready to learn, be ready to persevere. That's what will take you forward. The biggest thing is attitude. When any organization recruits, apart from the stamp you carry of the institute, it's the attitude. And that is what takes you forward in life. Day before yesterday, there was a national HR summit, and somebody was narrating this example at Procter & Gamble. A person who joined as an assistant security guard, not even as a security guard, as an assistant security guard, rose up to become the director of human resources of Procter & Gamble India. Can you imagine that? A matriculate, couldn't speak English. It is his attitude. From an assistant security guard to director of human resources, Procter & Gamble India. It's an unimaginable story. And P&G is a global multinational. But we saw that person's attitude was positive. He was customer-oriented, focused, people-oriented, high EQ level. See where he has been. Imagine that. So it is all about attitude. The institute, your education, helps you enter an organization. Beyond that, it is you. It is your attitude which is going to take you forward. NDIM can help you get an offer. You may join and a very nice organization. After that, it's entirely up to you. Then you can't come back to NDIM and say, okay, sorry, you didn't teach me this. That time will never come back. So it is entirely up to you. So that's what I'm saying. Apart from studies, there are a lot of other things which you need to getting up to speed with. Start honing those skills. That is what is going to make you successful professional in corporate life. Have your attitude at the right place. That's the only thing which takes you forward in an organization. That's a big differentiator. Be a solution, not a problem. Actually, it is everything. Attitude is everything. There is nothing, there is no substitute for attitude. One small example I would like to give you. Leaders with humility and fierce resolve. So this is the last example I'm quoting to you. How many have you heard about a person called Darwin Smith? As expected, you have heard? Darwin Smith? Who's he? That's Charles Darwin. Well, I expected that. So there was another hand I saw. So if that was also Charles Darwin, so please don't raise your hand again. Any? No? Okay. So nobody knows Darwin Smith. So they are leaders with humility, but a very strong resolve. There are certain names which you will all would be knowing about. Lee Iacocca. Right? Okay, that's the proof that you guys don't read. Al Dunlap, Jack Welch to pata hoga, nahi? Jack Welch, no? General Electric, GE. He is known as almost the father of the management in GE. Stanley Galt. Not aware? Sir, please make sure that these guys read. They're not. These are icons of management. There are books about them. You go to any bookshop, outside every bookshop will have these books plastered. Lee Iacocca, Jack Welch. His most famous book is Stay from the Gut. So apart from a textbook, please have these books issued, if they are in your library, read them. These are the people who are the, let's say, stars in management. If there's any quote which has to be taken, everybody approaches them for their quote. They are the people who build management theories. They are the people who outshone everybody in, let's say, management side. I am telling you this thing that you don't have to be a superstar to make a difference or make an impact. Now I'm coming back to Mr. Darwin Smith. Have you heard about the name Kimberly Clark? Whenever you visit a good quality toilet, you'll find Kimberly Clark stuff there. They're the world's largest in toiletry supplies. So in 71, he was an ordinary person working in Kimberly Clark, a very old paper company in US, doing very bad, 36% down in the market. The share prices were at the dump. He was an in-house lawyer, just a lawyer. Not many people knew him in the organization. Somehow, due to hierarchical areas, he was named as the CEO of the organization. When he was announced as the CEO of the organization, the board of directors, out of that one director, pulled him out and said, but you are not CEO material. You don't even have qualification to become a CEO. But since he had already been announced, he was taking over as CEO of Kimberly Clark. And he remained CEO for 20 years in Kimberly Clark. In that period, he did marvelous recovery for Kimberly Clark. He outshone the growth trajectories by 4.1 times. Companies like Hewlett Packard, 3M, Coca-Cola and General Electric. A person who people thought would fail. He doesn't look like a CEO. He is not qualified to be a CEO, but he delivered because he was humble. He had the resolve to perform. He had a goal to achieve, and he did that with his perseverance. So what I'm trying to tell you is that you may not be top-notch, you may not be a very well-known professional, but everybody can make a difference in the organization. Go with that resolve in mind. Go with that commitment in mind that I will make a difference. I will make it happen. And then nothing can stop you. So that was a small example of a person not many of us know, but he brought this company, and it is the world's largest solidary supply company in based out of US. Even India, I think, is a big market for Kimberly Clark now. So you are right now in a college. It's a laboratory. Treat these years as your learning and experimental years. Some thoughts I want to leave you with. Take risks. Risks not on the road. So don't quote me wrong. Risks in your professional learning life. Be innovative. Take initiative. Try and solve problems. Instead of just talking about problems, find solutions. That will help you become a better professional. Have a can-do attitude. You know why Indians are better managers than anybody else? Apart from the other traits I talked about, Indians can't say no. And that's a proven thing. If you work in a large organization, and if your boss talks about certain things, that, Suresh, can you do this? Now, Suresh knows that this can't be done, but he will never say no. That's our trait. We don't say no to our superiors. What happens then? Suresh knows that this can't be done. It's not possible. But I dare not say no to my superior. What will he do? He will make an attempt because he's committed. Like I mentioned, people are committed. Indians are committed. He will make an attempt. And there are 50% chances he may succeed. And since he's emotionally connected to that thing, he will make sure that he succeeds. He will work through odds. He will be innovative. Deliver it. That's a success factor which comes out. So take chances, take risks, take initiatives, and try and deliver. It's very easy to say no. Very easy to say no. You know, not possible. So that's the end of it. You lost the opportunity. But be innovative, think differently, and you will find solutions. Be perseverance. Have perseverance as a motto. Be positive and be collaborative. So these are some key words which look simple. But when you start your work life, they become very, very important aspects. And you will be measured against these things on your annual performance management cycle when it happens. These areas will get measured for you. You'll be very surprised, but these will be measured. And then that will define your movement in the organization. Above all, be always humble and compassionate. These are some traits of great leaders. Please imbibe them in your day-to-day life. So we lost this fine gentleman 2 days ago. I always quote this. You would have got it on your WhatsApp. Everybody is getting, I think, hundreds of messages now. Dream is not what you see in sleep. Dream is a thing which doesn't let you sleep. I think that is a very potent statement Dr. Kalam has given us. that have a big dream and don't sleep after you have that dream in your mind. Work towards it. Strive towards it. And no matter what comes, no matter what hurdles come in your way, work around it and be a winner and succeed in your life. Thank you so much for your time. So any questions you have, you want to interact? I would like some of you to ask some questions. Some of you have been very attentive, some of you haven't been very attentive. I can see everybody here. So if there's anything in your mind, any questions, any doubts, happy to answer.
Very good, good morning, sir. My name is Anmol Tiwari, and my question is, sir, what are the career options for an PGDM student in your Fortis, since it is a medical firm?
See, medical firm is not that we only recruit doctors. Like, I'm not a doctor, I work for Fortis. So, there are various other aspects of professional life at Fortis. And we've got people in finance, we've got people in human resources, sales, marketing, like any other organization. So, healthcare is beyond doctors also. Doctors do perform surgeries, they do the clinical work. But beyond that, the ecosystem is very similar to any other organization. So, a lot of opportunities in Fortis.
So, sir, that may also include a marketing department in
Of course, we have a marketing function.
Marketing,
if you, obviously all of you would be on YouTube. So, please go and look up our new ad, which is there on YouTube. It got launched about a week back. It's got 1 million hits last night at about 8 o'clock. So it's becoming very popular, hands of hope. So you can go and see that. So that's what marketing does for Fortis. And it's a very crucial role marketing plays. And so marketing, sales, finance, human resource, strategy, business intelligence, business planning, supply chain, they're all like any other organization.
Thank you, sir. Myself, Salman Wahid. Sir, I just want to ask, sir, how does in your organization reverse mentoring and the mentoring tradition process work? Because it is the totally been out of our as a mentoring or reverse mentoring, totally based on a management companies and all. But your company is related to medical. So that I want to ask. Reverse mentoring process.
Yeah, so we have both processes, mentoring and reverse mentoring. So when a new person joins the organization, suppose you join the organization tomorrow, so we'll take out an announcement that Salman has joined the organization and Mr. So-and-so will be his buddy mentor. So that's the start of your life at Fortis. So when you arrive, we allocate a friend to you, right? Everybody knows that this person is buddy mentor for Salman. So he'll guide you through the entire settling down process in the organization. He'll spend time with you. If you have any queries, he'll help you get all the settling issues sorted out. That's the first level of mentoring. Second is, the moment you are starting your work life, you want to know more about the organization, you want to know more about the culture of the organization. So, we give you an option of selecting out of a list of senior mentors, and then we arrange for those meetings with the mentors, and then they take you as a mentee. So, that mentoring starts then. They imbibe you with all the cultural aspects, the value systems, how the organization works, and what are the scopes for you as an individual in the organization. And in case you ever get bogged down by certain things, you can always either pick up the phone and go and talk to the mentor, meet him personally. So that's the mentoring process, usually. The reverse mentoring process is, we also have a list of young mentors, youngsters. Because the way the expectations of the young generation are, like I mentioned in my presentation, some of the people in the organization who have been there for many, many years don't understand that expectation. We want the people who have been in the organization for many years to be updated with the new ways of working, with the new thought processes. So that is what we call reverse mentoring. So we allocate a youngster, or maybe two youngsters, to a senior professional in the organization, for a general discussion, chit chat, and they understand what are the needs of the young generation, so that when the time to frame policies come, they keep all those things in mind. Otherwise, people who have been working for 30 years, 35 years in the organization, they have a very different view how the organization should run, so which sometimes ignores the needs of the younger generation. So the reverse mentoring brings that aspect into life.
Thank you, sir.
Talk on the mic, please.
Hi, sir. My name is Mohammed Sattar. Since you have decades of experience in HR, I would like to know, is this a myth or is it reality that girls are more preferred than boys for HR work? And what are the prospects of HR personnel for us? And what are the qualities which we can imbibe for it? So I have three basic questions regarding.
Your first question, yes, the girls now opt for HR more. It's not that you need girls versus boys, that's not like that. But more and more girls opt for HR. Because the kind of jobs which HR offers, some of them are more suitable for girls than boys. But that again is sector specific. If you go towards manufacturing, you will hardly find any girls on the shop floor in HR. You will only find boys. So it depends on what kind of work allocation is there within HR. So there are areas like compensation, comp and ben, policy framework, so girls do very well over there. But when it comes to unionized places, then you mostly have men over there handling those areas. So yes, but more and more girls are opting for HR as a profession. But there is nothing which, let's say, organizations have decided, okay, we'll have to hire only girls for